This conference will now be recorded.
Hello all, hello. Hello. Hello, can anyone hear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay, nice. 82 and counting. Shall we start once it reaches above 90? Okay. Sorry for the delay, but actually we had a meeting in the principal's office, so the delay. Okay. Yeah, hello. We'll start. Okay, it is 10:38. Okay. Good morning, all. Okay. Today's class will be on aortic congenital heart diseases. Okay. This was actually asked by you because it has been so long. I think you guys have heard it from, and there is few glitches from the department itself. But okay, finally we made it to here. Aortic heart diseases. Okay, everyone with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay, thank you. Okay. See, broadly, see, this is of some clinical importance, actually, your case presentation and all, because your eighth semester, you are expected to have a broad idea of heart disease. Okay. Yeah. The thing is, just remember, it is any heart diseases are broadly classified as two different. Okay, either it is congenital or acquired heart disease. Okay, whenever a child walks into your OP or your office, then these two things, when you're thinking of any heart disease, or this is maybe this is a case of CVS. Okay, two things, whether it is a congenital one or an acquired one. Acquired one is, yes, it is, as the name suggests, it is not from birth. It has been acquired meanwhile while growing up. The child must have caught up with something, and that has resulted into the disease. Okay, that is an acquired one. As the name suggests, congenital. Okay, congenital is obviously from birth. The main thing is there is a difference and a defect from birth, actually. Okay, this is a defect from birth, and the anatomy and physiology is being affected. Okay, this is just like your MBBS, your first year subjects, like anatomy and physiology are gone. Okay, then you're dealing with these things. Okay, that is your congenital heart disease. Okay, whenever there is a congenital heart disease, then there is another classification. Okay, you found out that this may be because of a defect from birth, so which means that the anatomy and physiology are gone. Then whether it is with the cyanosis or without cyanosis. Okay, cyanosis is cyanotic congenital heart diseases. Without cyanosis is acyanotic congenital heart diseases. Okay, that is next step to the understanding. Okay, Then there is, whenever there is a heart disease, whenever there is heart involved, it's the most associated one is the lung. Okay, it is, so everything is in collaboration with the heart, right? Like cardiopulmonary bypass, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, cardiopulmonary unit. Okay, which means that they both go hand in hand. So the next thing we need to know is how badly the lung is affected because of the defect of the heart. Okay, so now the next question comes, how is the heart affecting the lungs? So there is a classification with increased pulmonary blood flow or with decreased pulmonary blood flow. This is the same classification for cyanotic heart diseases and acyanotic heart diseases. Okay, when coming to the acyanotic heart disease, our topic for today, the few conditions with increased pulmonary blood flow and few conditions with decreased pulmonary blood flow. The conditions with increased pulmonary blood flow is your shunt lesions. See, like your ASDs, VSDs, and PDA. Why this is increased blood flow to the pulmonary circulation is, our heart normally is a high pressure circulation of the left side and low pressure circulation on the right side. Okay, whenever there is a breach in its demarcation, blood flows from higher pressure to the lower pressure, that is from the left to the right, and the right already getting from the blood from the body will also get blood from the left side, so the pulmonary circulation will be increased. You are getting the point, right? Already, I'll repeat it again, that right heart is already getting blood from the body, and also because of the pressure difference, the left heart is also giving the blood to the right side because of the breach in its walls. So there is high volume in the right heart, so that will give you high volume to the pulmonary circulation. So this is the basic pathogenesis for your increased pulmonary blood flow, and the conditions are obviously, just think, a breach in the atrias, ASD, a breach in the ventricles, VSD, a breach in the great arteries, the next step, that is PDA. Okay, wherever the blood flows from left to right in all the conditions. Okay, this is just a broad idea, and just to understand, the decreased blood flow is your pulmonary stenosis, aortic stenosis, coarctations, because the name suggests, you know, the constriction is there, so obviously the blood is not flowing into the lungs. Okay, just this is the broad classification. Now coming to the topic, the first one is ASD, okay, atrial septal defect. As we can understand, it is breach in the wall of the wall between the ventricular atrias. Okay, the left and the blood flows from the left to the right side. And statistics first, as an isolated anomaly, it is only seen in 10% of the heart diseases. And see, regarding female and male preponderance, just remember, your ASDs and PDAs are female. Okay, ASD and PDA are female. VSD is equal sex. Okay, there is no preponderance for male and female. Just remember, ASD, PDA are female most common. Okay, in this case, it is 1:2. And 50% of children have ASD as part of cardiac defects. Okay, because ASD is not just be isolated, but it can also present with a lot of other defects also. Okay, increasing referred as murmur. Usually these cases with ASD, they will be quite normal in their all other activities and everything. But maybe in a well baby clinic, or while the child is coming from for a immunization, some pediatrician looks at the chest and finds a murmur occasionally, but the child is otherwise normal, no cyanosis, obviously there is no other defect, but the child is having a murmur and he wants the evaluation. So that is how an ASD comes up to the surface. Okay, auscultatory finding is helpful for detection, and ECG is very helpful. Okay, this is how an ASD will be identified. Otherwise, ASDs are subtle ASDs are cool and not much defects they do. That is because the defect is in the atrial septal wall, which is having a gradient of only 0 to 5 mm of HEG, where the right atria is 0 mm of HEG and the left atria is around 5 mm of HEG. So the pressure difference is only 5. So the blood shunting, possibly shunting, will not produce much of thing actually. You know, the heart can acclimatized over a small spurt of blood. Okay, that is why ASDs are subtle in presentation. Okay, so we see coming to the types. Actually, there are three major types. These three are major types. There are other two minor types for UG. Actually, it is the secondum, primum, and sinus venosus. Of which secondum is very common, and 70 to 80%. It is ostium secundum. As you must be very much aware of atrial wall development, as you can see in this pic. Okay, first of all, there is a temporary layer that is formed, that is ostium primum, and if the temporary layer itself is defective, it is ostium primum. It just blows off, and once the temporary is formed during development, again there is a resolution of the temporary one, and again the secondary wall comes out, that is ostium secundum, which defects will result in ostium secundum. And and the other is sinus venosus type, because these are the inlets of a right atrium. The inlets of right atrium is superior vena cava, inferior vena cava, and coronary sinuses. Okay, this, if the defect is at the coronary sinuses, it is sinus venosus type. Okay, there is other superior vena cava type and also inferior vena cava type. These are also there, but they are minor. Okay, just remember, secundum is most common, it is 70 to 80%, and primum is less prevalent among these things. Okay, yep. Yeah, regarding patent foramen ovale, there is a defect, but it is just a closed flap that is having. There is only closed flap, and there is no right atrial or left right atrial or right ventricular enlargement. So that is why it is called patent foramen, and that's all. There is an opening, but it is not producing any hemodynamical abnormalities. Okay, that is a common finding in pediatric population, and a newborn will be having patent foramen ovale, and it gets resolved over time, and there is no much significance to it. Just remember that PFO, that is patent foramen ovale, is a milder form of ASD. Okay, now coming to the ASD, as such, this as we discussed, it is a left to right shunt, and the patients will be mostly asymptomatic because there is no much blood flowing into the in and out of the and left and the right, so there is no much problem. So it is usually presents with asymptomatically. Okay, and it is, as it is not symptomatic, the time of detection will be obviously late, and it will be in the late infancy and childhood. Okay, and coming to the clinical features, the pulse rate will be normal, and BP will also be normal. Okay, and coming to the auscultation, this is important, and the examiner expects you to say this. In auscultation, there will be wide fixed split of S2. The thing is, why it is they'll ask you the pathogenesis. Just listen to this. There is fixed split because it is not changed. See, your S2 is mostly A2P2. Okay, your aorta should close, and only then your pulmonary wall should close. And with good ears, they will find a differentiation between A2 and P2. Okay, your S2 is divided into two things. It is there. When you are in deep inspiration, you can find it much better actually. But in ASD, even during inspiration or expiration, you can easily find the splitting. This is normal. Dip, 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 dip. This is the split of A2 and P2 that we can appreciate in case of ASD. This is classic and characteristic of ASD. Okay, and this is what will be asked in your exam, and examiner expects this from you. Okay. Yeah, and there can be ejection systolic murmur at the pulmonary area. This is because there is more blood that is flowing through the pulmonary wall, so there is a chance that we can see an ejection systolic murmur at the pulmonary area. And there can be mild diastolic murmur, MDM murmur, okay, in the left lower sternal border. Okay, that is mid diastolic murmur, and it is at left lower sternal border. This is also because of there is more blood flowing through the mitral area. Okay, coming to the investigations, your ECG, because there is more blood and more work being done, there is on the right side there will be right axis deviation. Just to remember, if at all there is a volume increase, all the muscle increase on the side, there will be that sided axis deviation. Like if the volume increases on the right side, it is right axis deviation. If the volume increases on the left side, it is left axis deviation. If the ventricles are enlarged on one side, the electrologically it will be changed into that side. Okay, deviation will be that side. So and the ASD, the blood is pouring into the right side, so right side is having more volume to deal with, so there will be right axis deviation. And there is RSR pattern. Okay, this RSR pattern is in, during your QRS complex, you will have a M pattern. Okay, M pattern over your right side chest leaves like V1 and V2. Okay, this can be seen in 85% of the case, and this usually clinches the diagnosis. Okay, you just if you are hearing a murmur, and if you are thinking of a splitted sound, and then the child is okay, absolutely, I mean, not much problem with him. And if you get an ECG, if you are finding an RSR pattern, if you are finding a right axis deviation, it is most probably ASD. You go for a echocardiography, and they will right away give you the diagnosis. Okay. And regarding chest X-ray, it is the cardiac size is of a variable size, because if there is only small blood that is trickling into the right side, there will not be much any difference of cardiac size and abnormalities. Otherwise, it is, if there is more blood, there can be right atrial enlargement because of more blood flow, and pulmonary blood flow will also be increased. As we discussed, this is a condition where there is increase in pulmonary blood flow, ASDs, VSDs, inferior. Okay, your echo, this will clinch the diagnosis. This is, you know the size, you know the type of ASD, whether it is sinus venosus, whether it is primum or a secondum. Okay, based on size, you can know how much mm is the defect, and how much flow gradient is also there between the two atrias. Okay, dilatation of right side will be there because of high overload, like right atrial enlargement, right ventricular enlargement, or your pulmonary artery, how much it is enlarged because of more volume. Okay, there is paradoxical motion of intraventricular septum, like your septum may be paradoxical motion, may be there because usually during contraction, the left side usually pushes towards the right side, but maybe in this, because of the more volume in the right side, you will feel that the right side, right ventricle is pushing the septum onto the left side because of high volume. Okay, that is your paradoxical motion of intraventricular septum. These findings are echo findings of an ASD. Okay, so you diagnosed the case of ASD clinically, and then you have taken an ECG, X-ray, and echo, and now you are seeing. Then you need to counsel the parent, right? You need to tell that yes, your child is having some defect, cardiac defect. So they're going to ask you, or you are expected to answer them. How is it? Like, it's common sense. Like, what are the chances of closure, whether it flows or not? Okay, those things. ASDs of size less than 4 mm, by 1.5 year, they usually close. Okay, by 4 to 8 mm, also they can close. Remember, in ASD, it is 8 mm. If it is more than 8 mm, the chances of closure is very less. and we may have to think of a device closure. Mostly we are doing device closure. Otherwise, if it fails, we have to go for a surgery, open heart. Okay. Just remember, ASD is 8 mm. And if it is more than 8 mm, there is less chance. Or if it is less than 8 mm, you can just call them up again. After 3 months, we'll do it again. And we keep checking the size of the ASD and also the clinical features. Because of high volume, the heart tends to go into failure. Okay. If untreated, congestive heart failure and pulmonary arterial hypertension develops in adults. As adults, because yes, as we mentioned it, adults, this can go unnoticed to adulthood also, ASD, because they will be relatively okay, because only small amount of blood is trickling, and over time, over years, that small amount keep on increases, the heart starts slowly fading its capacity and working ability, and slowly it comes down. And at one point of time over in adolescence or in adulthood, it will just give way and will go into failure. Okay. And your endocarditis prophylaxis is not required in case of ASD. Okay. Usually, any heart disease, just remember, like any shunt lesions, any heart disease, they are at risk of infected endocarditis. Even in ASD, you write infected endocarditis, you are not wrong. Okay. There is all the shunt lesions has a tendency to go through this, and there is high chance that they will go into this thing. But your prophylaxis, your dental extractions and any oral surgeries and throat infections, your prophylaxis may not be needed in case of small ASDs. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Regarding the diagnosis mode of you see your examiners, our teachers, they are not into much of echocardiography. They always they can diagnose clinically, so they'll expect the same from us actually. But I know this is not practical. Like everybody of you must be thinking, if you are suspecting a cardiac lesion, why don't you just get an echo and done? Why all these murmurs, areas, grades, and all stuff? But it is the pro forma, right? It goes well. Okay. Previously, when echoes are not there, they used to diagnose the condition only by physical examination. So that is that important, and the heart really shows out for us to hear. Okay. So mode of diagnosis is always physical examination, clinical and clinical. Okay. Only then it comes to your ECG with RSR pattern and right side axis deviation. Your chest X-ray may show your right side heart enlargement, and of course echo. Okay. And spontaneous closure, rare if defect is 8 mm at birth and rare after 2 years of age. Okay. If it is 6 mm and it is 6 mm even after 2 years, 3 years, 4 years of age, then there is no chance, no point in waiting, because the heart tends to fail over time. So you need to plan for closure. Okay. And very rarely, not that it stays like that or it will come down. Very rarely there is a chance that ASDs can enlarge, the foramen can increase its size because of the flow. Okay, yeah. Regarding patent foramen ovale, as we discussed, it is just a small defect in the fova ovalis, the primary shunt a region with a flap with no evidence of right heart volume overload. Okay. This is important. There is no overload. If at all there is an overload, it will be called as an ASD. If at all there is no overload, it is just a plain patent foramen ovale. Okay. It is a normal finding in newborns. Okay. Now indication, as we discussed, asymptomatic, you can wait for 2 to 4 years because there is a chance of closure. So you will wait for, usually you will wait for 5 years, and then you'll think of closing it. Okay. Asymptomatic. If the child is doing well, growing well, the child is on all ways, it is well, you will wait. If it is a symptomatic child, we may have to get it operated. As we mentioned, the size is more than 8 mm and it is not coming down over time, you may have to go for the procedure. Okay. Usually by 1 year or 18 months, we can wait. And then after that, we can go ahead with the closure. Okay. Because early the best. Okay. Yeah. And then the methods of closure are basically your surgical and device closure. Mostly they do device closure nowadays. They'll put a catheter, closure the umbrella like, and it will get opened into the shunt, and then they'll close the shunt. And the weight they give is more than 10 kgs. This is nothing to do with the heart or something. It is only for the ease of the anesthetist, okay? And a 10 kg body takes a better anesthesia than a less weight, okay? So they'll wait for 10 kg. Okay, this is a brief understanding of the ASDs. Now we'll just drop down to VSD, okay? This is your ventricular defect, ventricular septal defect. And regarding the location, see, there are many classification of VSD, whether it is restrictive, non-restrictive. You will find it in different books, your clinical, different clinical books and this thing. Restrictive, non-restrictive. If the defect is very large, it is non-restrictive. The blood can easily flow from in and out. As I come across, just imagine that there are two adjacent rooms with a partition in between, and in one room, if there is an the temperature is very low, like one room is well air conditioned and the other room is not air conditioned, just remember like this, and you feel the defect in between. If the door is a big door, you can find that the both rooms are maintaining the same temperature, and if the door is a small door, you will find that the temperature difference is more. Okay, the same thing happens in the ventricles with two sides, right and left ventricle, and the defect in the middle. Okay, just remember the dynamics with this analogy. Okay, and based on the location, it is types, like four types, whether it is type one outlet, as the name suggests, it is outlet during the outlet, like your subpulmonic or supracrystal defects. Okay, that is type 1, and type 2 is perimembranous, and type 3 inlet defect, and type 4 muscular defect. See, regarding IVS, the intraventricular septum, that part that is towards the atria is your membranous part, okay, and towards the floor of the ventricles, it is the muscular part and the membranous part. Okay, these will constitute the IVS. Okay, and above the, there is one inlet and one outlet. Outlet is your which will go into the pulmonary and aortic, and the inlet is at the atrial ends. Okay, briefly, this is the classification. Yeah, coming to the types, based on the sizes, it is, coming to the types, based on the size, it is large, moderate, and small. As we discussed, if the door, if the partition in between the rooms are very big, the blood flows happily in and out of the rooms. So that is a non-restrictive. The diameter of the defect is approximately equal to the diameter of the aortic orifice. They usually compare it with the aortal orifice. If the aortal orifice is as big, the defect is as big as the aortal orifice, the blood can go into the aorta or into the right ventricle. Okay. So there is no restriction to the flow, and right ventricular systolic pressure is usually the same as a systemic pressure, the same pressure, because normally your left ventricular pressure is very high. It will be around your systolic pressure is 120 by 80. It will be around 100, and the right is around 15 to 20 mmHg, because the difference is so big that it will be around 90 to 100 mm of Hg. So if the wall in between is defective, the blood gushes into the right side from the left side. This will be your hemodynamics. Okay? And degree of left to right shunt depends on pulmonary vascular resistance. Okay, just remember this pulmonary vascular resistance, because the right heart has to give the blood to the lungs. And regarding moderate, it is a bit restrictive, because the blood is not flowing much ease, because the orifice, the defect is lesser than the aortic orifice. So blood wants to go into the aorta than it wants to go into the right atria, right ventricle. Okay, right ventricular pressure is half to two-thirds of systemic pressures, and left to right shunt is more than 2:1. Okay. It is the systemic to pulmonary circulation. The 2:1 is 2 is your, if there is 3 liters of blood that is pumped in, 2 liters goes into the aorta and 1 liter goes into the right side. Okay, that is the equation of 2:1. Okay, when in case of small and restrictive, the diameter is very small compared to the aortic orifice, that is less than 1/3, and the right ventricular pressure is normal because the defect is not very big. The right ventricular pressure holds its own pressure of around 40 mm of Hg compared to the 120 or 140 of left ventricle, and the shunt will be less than 2:1. Okay, not much of the blood goes into the right side and most of it goes into the aorta. Okay, this is regarding the defect size. Okay, big, moderate, large, moderate and small. Yeah, this is what we discussed about. The top part is perimembranous, this is membranous, and this is the muscular part. Okay, see the wall, left ventricle is very muscular compared to the right ventricle, because right ventricle, the purpose of right ventricle is just to put blood into the adjacent lung, but left ventricle has to do the job. It has to pump the blood to the toes of the body, so it will be, it has to be more muscular. Okay, this is the muscular part of IVS, and this is the membranous part of IVS. Okay, when the defect is there, this is the subpulmonic or the type 1 defect. Okay, yeah, this is non restrictive, this is very big opening. Okay, and blood can as well go into the aorta or into the right ventricle. Okay, this is very big. Then regarding the hemodynamics, and now coming to the clinical presentation, how they present. This is small, how small can present, how large. Okay, small VSD, as we discussed, not much blood goes into the right side, so they will be relatively asymptomatic, and this is also an incidental finding. Somebody puts the stent on the chest, will hit a murmur, will be knowing a murmur, and then they'll come to a conclusion that maybe this child has to be evaluated, and once you go for an investigation with the clinical examination, you may find out that maybe we are dealing with the case of VSD. Okay, in case of large defects, large VSDs, there will be growth defect, there will be developmental delay, and there will be pulmonary infections which are repeated, and over time it may go into congenital heart failure also. Okay, this is regarding large VSDs. Why there will be growth and developmental defect? Because the blood that has to go to the body will not go into the body, but most of the blood will go into the lungs, which are already been well equipped with blood. So the growth and development will be affected. And because there is more blood in the pulmonary circulation, there will be more preponderance, a very wetty area is there around the lungs. So there will be high chance of infections, pulmonary infections in case of VSDs. And the heart tends to fail over time because of overload. Okay, and with long-standing pulmonary hypertension, a history of cyanosis, and a decreased activity. See, over time what happens is it will go into Eisenmenger's syndrome. Okay, what is Eisenmenger's is the left shunts will become a right shunt, because over time the pulmonary pressures will increase and the flow from the left to right decreases, and the flow from right to left starts, and the child will become cyanotic. That is very bad, and the prognosis is very poor. Okay, and regarding the mode of diagnosis, it is, yes, physical examination, as we discussed, examination, this is the clinical thing, and ECG, X-ray, and echo. Echo, you know, there will be defect size and site, and everything can be measured. Chest X-ray, X-ray will tell you the enlargement of heart and left to right this thing, and the pulmonary plethora of the lung fields. And during ECG, yeah, as we discussed, ECG will give you right axis deviation. Okay, and now coming to the clinically, how you want to find it clinically, your examination is S1 can be normal and S2 can be lower because increase in pulmonary circulation. Okay, S2 is A2 P2. Okay, and there will be wide split with the variable P2 because in ASD it is fixed split, wide and fixed, and here there will be wide split with variable P2. Okay. Why it is a wide split is there will be normally A2 P2 should be there, but because there is more blood flowing into the pulmonary wall, this P2 will take some more time to close, like tick, tick, should be like tick, tick, tick. Okay, the P2 will be a bit prolonged. Okay, that is how there will be wide splitting. And closely split will be there in pulmonary arterial hypertension. Once there is hypertension, there is not much blood flowing into the pulmonary circulation, so there will be decrease in the split, like tick, 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 or it will become a single sound, like tick, 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 tick. Okay, and yeah, the murmur is very characteristic. It is pan-systolic murmur at the left lower sternal border. Okay. Or middle sternal border, whatever it is, okay. And there is a mid diastolic murmur at the apex, okay. That is because of increased blood flow from the pulmonary wall. Yeah, this is the murmur, that is murmur, and how you can identify it. This is a pan systolic murmur, S1, S2, S3, S4. S1 to S2, there is a pan systolic one, okay. It is pan systolic, the murmurs. Stays like that, and you can know that it is a moderate. When there is a small VSD, it is a very harsh. Just remember the murmur intensity in a VSD. If the defect is small, the sound will be more, like very harsh and very terrifying. When the defect is more, the blood is easily flowing and left to right, so the murmur will be very soft and calm. Just because the murmur is less, that doesn't mean the defect is low, and just because the murmur is very harsh and very violent, it doesn't mean it is a serious disease. Maybe it is a small VSD that we are dealing with. Okay, and in case of small and large VSDs, it may not be a pan systolic, like involving all of the systole. Maybe it is only the initial part of the systole may be involved, like tick, tick, tick. Okay, pan systolic is okay. That is the difference between a moderate VSD and a small or large VSD. Okay, in small or large, only the harshness of the murmur is the differentiating finding. Okay, if it is more harsh, it is small. If it is less harsh, it is large. Okay, now you clinically or other investigations, you found out that there is a VSD. Now, how do you counsel the parent? Like, how do you tell them the future of it? Okay, about 10% of large non-restrictive die by first year or 1 year of age. Okay, because there is a large defect, there is more blood flowing in, so the heart will very quickly work more and will fade, and eventually there will be a failed heart. Okay, and spontaneous closure is very uncommon. Okay, in case of large VSDs, and the 40% of moderate to small, usually they close majority by 5 years. You will wait for 5 years, as in case of ASD also, we will wait for 4 to 5 years for the things to settle down, because the heart will grow, and if it grows in a good way, it can close. Okay, and regarding the type of VSD that can get closed, your membranous, as the name suggests, it is a membrane, so there is a less chance of closure. If it, the defect is there in the muscular part of the VSD, muscular part of septum, there is a chance to close because the muscle grows, right? The muscle grows and the defect can close off. Okay, and size usually decreases in 25% of the cases. Okay, if it is a smaller moderate, you just keep serial echoes to find the size. Okay, now coming to the timing of closure, large VSDs with uncontrolled failure, you immediately should close, because by 1 year they are going to succumb, and we are going to lose the patient. So as early as possible, large VSDs, you please close them. Okay, and large VSDs with pulmonary arterial hypertension, even early, not even 1 year, because the pulmonary vasculature is also changed, so there is no time to wait. You better close it very quickly, 3 to 6 months. Okay, moderate VSDs with pulmonary systolic pressure, 66% of the pressure, you can wait for 1 to 2 years, and small VSDs you can wait for 2 to 4 years. You just remember the thing. Yeah, as the seriousity decreases, obviously you're going to push it further, right? Because by 4 years you are going to wait, because by the time if it closes, it closes. Okay. Where the number is 8 in case of ASDs, the small outlet VSDs of less than 3 without any prolapse, you just keep waiting for 1 to 2 years, maybe it closes. Okay. Here the measurement is 3, 5, 10 mm. Okay. Small, medium, and large. In some books they say that 5 and 10. But usually 3, 5, 10. Okay, where 3 is small VSD, moderate is 5, and 10 mm is large VSD. Okay, and how do you close the VSD? Just like ASD, you should close with surgical closure or device closure with more than 15 kgs. This is the same thing. Okay, and pulmonary arterial banding can be done because pulmonary artery is also going to be having more pressure because more blood flows. So more pressure, so pulmonary arterial banding can also be done. And if it is in case of multiple VSDs, like small like Swiss cheese appearance, there is the septum will be like a sieve, a lot of holes in it. Okay, in those cases you can't occlude the defect so many times, you can't put so many devices, so you do the pulmonary arterial banding so that you increase the pressure so that the shunt will decrease. Okay, that is, these are the processes: device closure and arterial banding. Now coming to the third one and the final in case for our class, it is PDA. This is the defect at the next level, the great arteries, the aorta and the pulmonary artery. Okay, as the logic says, the same thing: the left side the pressure is more, the right side the pressure is less, so the blood flows from right, left to right. Okay, this is the ductus arteriosus. Everybody knows that this is the normally at the during birth, the fetal circulation, there is an opening and it is persisting even after birth, so the defect. Okay, and the diagnosis is as usual: clinical, physical examination, ECG, X-ray, and echo. Okay, now coming to the clinical thing, is just in a tabular format. And here it is small, moderate, and large. Here small is around 1 mm because PDA of any size is to be dealt seriously. Okay, the VSDs, ASDs is light, VSD moderate, but PDA any size is dangerous. Okay, because aorta will have 120 by 80 pressure and your pulmonary artery is not going to have that much pressure. So definitely it is going to put blood into the pulmonary circulation. So this is defective. So make sure that you close a PDA. Okay, where here in clinical examination, the pulses are in small PDA, you will feel the pulses normal. But in moderate to large PDA, you will feel bounding pulses. You feel there is a high volume pushing. Okay, why there will be high volume is, even though the blood is not the blood is going from the aorta into the pulmonary circulation, it will again revert back into the left ventricle. Okay, and left ventricle will be overloaded, so you will have a bounding pulse. Okay, because somebody may ask a doubt, like if the blood is moving from aorta to the pulmonary circulation, why should there be more bounding pulse on the arteries? Okay, this is because the blood that goes into the lung, again it will add up to the left side, so there will be bounding pulse. And BP, there will be wide pulse pressure in small or moderate or large. The pulse pressure usually should be 20 to 40. And if it is more, it is wide pulse pressure. Okay. And clinical examination will be normal in case of a small PDA, but moderate to large, you can find more clinical finding. Like the apex will be normal in case of small PDA. And the apex will be left ventricular apex because more blood is flowing to the left side of the heart in PDA, because the right atrium is good, left, right ventricle is good, but only the pulmonary arteries are not good. There is an abnormal connection. So the more blood goes into the right side of the heart. So the left side of the heart from the lungs. So the left ventricle will be overloaded. So in moderate and large, there will be left ventricular apex. And there will be continuous murmur, as you know, missionary murmur, continuous murmur in case of a PDA. And thrill, as there is more blood, there will be more murmur and more thrill. So in small PDAs, they won't be there, but in moderate to large PDAs, you can see thrill. And MDM murmur, mid-diastolic murmur, will be there in case of moderate to large. Again, it is your flow murmur, more blood, and you'll get more. As you can see, MDM is seen in ASDs, in very severe ASDs, in VSDs, and also in PDA. Very good ears will differentiate between continuous murmur and a mid-diastolic murmur, because continuous murmur goes like it is continuous murmur. Along with this, there will be a mid-diastolic murmur. A very soft ears will find this difference. Okay, yeah, systolic component of the murmur will be there only in case of large PDA. Okay, this is what the murmur in case of PDA. See, it is using all the space. All this is S1 and this is S4. This is using all the space in case of moderate PDA. In large PDA also, it is using all the thing. Okay. In severe PAH, it will resist the flow because the pulmonary arteries will resist the more flow. So it will drop down only to the first half, and it will become like a pan-systolic murmur. Like only the systolic murmur will be there, but the diastole will be normal. Okay, in case of high pressures from the pulmonary artery. I know this sounds a bit too much to you guys, but actually get sensitized so that once you're going through the cardiology, you'll understand it more, because cardiology is more of understanding. And during reading cardiology for pediatrics, your OP guy is superior to Nelson, because OP guy, the author is Standen, and he's a very good cardiologist, and he has his own book of cardiology. Okay, so OP guy's cardiology is one of the best. Okay, OP guy is very much enough and very nicely given, actually. Okay, yeah, coming to the few Viva questions, where you can see continuous murmur with a pink child, your PDA, any fistulas, any arterial pulmonary windows, Alcapa, Luttenbacher syndrome. Luttenbacher is your ASDs with mitral wall defect, coarctation, all these. You can just say fistulas and aortic pulmonary windows and outlet. I know this is right single outlet ventricle, like single ventricle. Okay, all these things will give you continuous murmurs. Okay, coming to the venous hum. This is a small blowing murmur, and this is of medium pitched, and these are all of academic things, actually. Okay, it can be seen in PDAs and fistulas, and in case of collaterals, in case of coarctation. Okay, venous hum. This is very soft blowing murmur, but arterial murmur will be very harsh and loud, but venous hum is very soft. Okay, it will be present in these tunnel borders, both sides. Okay, as it is venous flow, there is no association with your heart sounds, S1 or S2, because if in case of arterial murmurs, there is matter of S1 and S2. In case of venous, there is no point, which increases on sitting up and neck flexed and decreases on lying down. This is all just how the venous comes in. Okay. And regarding the size of PDA and its significance, large PDA, more blood goes, and there will be heart failure early. Okay, moderate PDA, there is some degree of overload, and pulmonary hypertension and CCF will take some time. Small PDA, small overload, and the chance of failure and pulmonary hypertension are very less. Okay, and silent PDA, there is something called silent PDA, that there is no murmur, no abnormalities. It is only found on Doppler. Yes, there is a defect. Other than that, there is nothing. The child will be normal. He will go into his adolescent and adult, and without anything, he'll just pass over the time. Okay, this is only an echo finding. That is silent PDA without any hemodynamical abnormality. Okay, spontaneous closure in case of small PDAs we can wait for 3 months, and large PDAs there is high chance that it will never close. Okay, here it is 3 months. Remember, because PDAs are very serious, because the blood is directly put into the, as the aorta is supplying to any other organ, it will supply to the lung also. So the lung get overloaded very fast. So there is not much time that is left. Okay, up to 3 months. For ASD, we are waiting for 5 years. For VSD, I mean moderate VSD also will wait for 5 years. But in case of PDA, you should be very strict. Okay, once it pressures develop, once the heart starts failing, it is very difficult to manage the child. You may lose the child early. Okay.
Yeah,
large PDAs, as we know, the complications are suggest to heart failure because of more volume and pulmonary hypertension, and early closure should be there, like in 3 to 6 months. And moderate PDA, no congestive heart failure, and up to 1 year you can wait. If failure or something is there, you need to fix it fast. And in small PDAs, you can wait 18 months, yeah, 1.5 year, you can wait until the child gets good weight and this. And silent PDA, as we know, as the definition or thinking, there is no hemodynamical abnormality. So you need not go for a procedure, because any procedure will have its complication, on table complication, be it anesthetic complication or anything. The child may survive the silent PDA closure is difficult. Okay, how do you close it? It is always device closure. There will be pigtail coils that will occlude. You will just put a catheter and leave the coil in the PDA so that there will be a flow will be stopped. Okay, and surgical ligation in case of less than 6 months of age, because if it is very big PDA, as we discussed, that it needs intervention fast, you cannot do a device closure, so you may have to go for a surgical ligation in case of small kids. Okay, less than 3 to 6 months. Okay, and indomethacin and ibuprofen, yes, they are usually in preterms they'll be used, and now studies show that in terms also you can go for it. And paracetamol is also as effective as indomethacin and ibuprofen. Even if you say paracetamol, you're not wrong, you can be right. Okay, yeah. And surgical ligation is in case of preterm. Surgical ligation is done after your medical management is done. This is logical, right? You'll try it through medication. If it is not working, you may have to resort to your surgical. Okay, and this actually ends the discussion for the increased pulmonary flow aortic heart diseases. And the following slides are regarding the decreased flow. Okay, so this ends our discussion. Any doubts? Hello?
No, sir.
Hello? Yeah, yeah. Any doubts? Hello? Somebody
respond?
No,
sir.
No, Pavan. Yeah. Understandable, at least 20 to 30% is understandable, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any doubts? If somebody is having any, because you have asked it again, I think if at all, I know that cardiology is difficult like this, but you just go through it once now itself. I mean today itself, so that you can understand it. It doesn't take much of time if you're reading from an OP guy. Just go through it now. In half an hour to 1 hour, you may find it. Okay, guys. Hello. Okay. Shall we end the session? If there is no doubts, we'll end it.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, fine, fine. Thank you all. Thank you for your patient hearing. Thank you.